Yes.
Yes.
Yeah? Did we?
Yes.
Glad to hear that. All right. Well, my talk tonight is called A Tale of Two Wolves. And it comes from an old Native American folktale where there's a young man, and within him, he is feeling this conflict. Like one day, he feels really bitter and resentful and angry and just wants to lash out. But then the next day, he feels loving and compassionate, wants to help others, right? To share kindness. But this battle keeps going on back and forth, right, inside of him. So finally, he goes to his grandfather and he explains this to his grandfather. His grandfather says that within each person, there are two wolves. There's the wolf of fear, which reacts like a fearful animal, right? Biting, snapping, bitterness, resentment. And then there's the wolf of love, which responds with kindness, love, compassion, peace. And that every person has these two wolves, and they're battling it out. The young man gets a little concerned, and he says, well, Grandfather, which wolf will win? And Grandfather says, the one you feed.
Yeah.
The one you feed. Now, all of us have this, right? We know there are two wolves living inside of us. Those moments where we feel really happy, kind, thoughtful toward others. And then there are those moments where we're snappy and snarky and maybe we get a little mean, right? That's the wolf of fear. But we always know which wolf we're feeding the most because we know how we're feeling, right? Are we feeling peaceful and joyful, or are we feeling resentful and bitter? So this is a metaphor, right? They're not actually two wolves that live inside of us. They're metaphors. That the wolf of love is us when we are making choices that honor our divine nature. The wolf of love has the distinct feeling of connectedness, awareness, that we are part of source energy, that we are an emanation of source energy, that source energy works through us, for us, as us. We are never unsupported. We are never alone. We have everything we need right inside of us. We might say things like, well, that was easier than I thought, or the universe has my back. Right? That's how it will feel when we are feeding the wolf of love. Now, the wolf of fear is the metaphor for when we are making choices that fail to honor our divine nature. What comes with that is the distinct feeling of separation. We believe we're dropped off on this planet, and our experience is all lack and limitation. We are victims. We believe bad things happen to us. We have no control over them. We are all alone. Okay, that is the wolf of fear, feeling all alone. The wolf of love responds to life and interacts with life, right? This is what we want to do, right? Interaction with life. The wolf of fear reacts to life. Now, responding to life means we interact. Reacting means we push against. Okay, we struggle with life. That's how we feed the wolf of fear. So I'm going to talk about a couple of things that we can do. So we have these great powers within us, but we can use them to make ourselves miserable just as easily as we can use them to make ourselves happy. Okay? So one of the most powerful things that we have going for us is our imagination. Imagination is very important, yet most people think imagination is just a little play thing. It's like, this is where you just dream up stuff, but you don't live your real life from there. You need to get serious. But do you know, everything that we see comes from somebody's imagination. Everything, right? The iPad that's recording this, right? The clothes that you're wearing, all the furniture in this room, everything comes from someone's imagination first. Imagination is actually so important that Ernest Holmes includes it in the creative process. If you have one of these cards, the second step in the creative process is about imagination, okay? The first step is to decide what you wish to have or do. That actually can take a lot of imagination too. But step two is to see, feel, and speak out loud your ideal outcome. Okay, your ideal outcome, it hasn't happened yet, right? So you have to use your imagination. You have to be able to visualize it. He also says in step three to repeat this until the outcome is in your life. Okay, we can't just dream up something one time and expect it to happen. We need to put a lot of focus and energy into this, okay? So it's very important. Now, imagination, we use our imagination for good and for bad, right? We feed the wolf of fear with our imagination by imagining worst case scenarios, right? We can be, our body will respond physiologically to an imagined stress, just like if it were real. This is why I do not watch any of the Jurassic Park movies after late afternoon. I will dream about them. And then I will be chased by dinosaurs. I will wake up. I can't breathe. I've broken out in a cold sweat. My heart is pounding. I have fear just in every part of my body because my body was acting like it was actually chased by a dinosaur. Okay, so our brain, it doesn't know if what we're imagining is true or not. It believes everything is true. Now, there's science behind this. I've been hearing it for like 25, 30 years, so it's out there somewhere, right? But our brain does not know the difference between something true and something that we are just totally making up, okay? So when we imagine a worst-case scenario, we're feeding the wolf of fear. What we want to do is feed the wolf of love. So we want to imagine, we want to use this creative process. We want to imagine our happy outcome about something. Right now, when we imagine a desired outcome, what happens is, first of all, our imagination creates something in the substance of divine mind. Right? And I always like to point to divine mind as right here. This is where my creative substance is. It's right there, just beyond my imagination. Okay, but what happens is we imagine something, a seed is planted, right? Now the brain thinks it's a true thing. So it does what it was made to do. It supports us in getting that thing. That's what our brain does. It's a computer. It just gets a job, and that's what it does, right? And the job is what we focus on the most, what we're thinking about the most. The next thing that happens is that we have a small, fearful part of our mind, right? And that's the part of us that puts resistance up when we're trying to step out of our comfort zone. Right? So everybody knows about that, and in some philosophies it's called the ego, right? That our ego, its only job is to keep us safe from cradle to grave. That's its only job. So if we decide to have an adventure and step outside of our comfort zone, our ego thinks that's dangerous, that adventure could kill you, you cannot go to a strange place, to somebody else's birthday party you've never met, because it could be dangerous, right? So it sets up resistance. And that resistance is like, well, you know, maybe I don't really want to do that, okay? Now, when we're imagining a happy outcome, the ego does something else. And most people don't know this. The ego has another job besides setting up resistance. When it thinks you've already done something, that you've already made that big jump, it's not going to try to set up resistance anymore because you've already done that thing. Instead, it's going to say, all right, there she goes. She did it anyway. Now we have to support her in any way we can so we can get this done and over with as quickly as possible. So that small, fearful part will actually jump to our aid when it believes we've already done it. It will believe we've already done it because we're imagining the outcome that we want. Okay? But this is important stuff. Now when we're imagining a worst-case scenario, we're also making that true for us. The body or the brain will jump to that, the ego will jump to that. When we're imagining worst case scenarios, we start experiencing physiologically, as if it is true, things like fear, doubt, intimidation, disempowerment, shame, resentment, bitterness. We'll feel all of those as if they are true. We'll feel them all. When that happens, we also become really terrible decision makers because every decision that we make will be based on the feeling of fear, limitation, doubt, intimidation, resentment, resistance, lack. That's what every decision will be based on when we're feeding the wolf of fear. Now, we're a storyteller, right? We want to tell the story of the happy outcome. When we start talking about the happy outcome, happens is there's a reaction, we get excited, we get enthusiastic, we receive inspiration, we start planning, We receive insight on how to actually make that happy outcome come into our life, right? Okay, so we're a storyteller. The brain doesn't know the difference between something that's true and not true. We're feeling it. As long as we're thinking it and feeling it, it's buying into it, right? But we think and feel a lot of crappy stuff too, don't we, right? So we want to think about those good things. We want to put our attention on that great thing because we're an archer, and where our attention is, that's our target, right? Think about what your target is. Is that really what you want to hit, right? If you do want to hit it, then yay, you're on the right track. Okay, so imagination. That's the first thing we want to pay attention to. How are we using it to feed the wolf of love? Now, Eckhart Tolle said the primary cause of unhappiness is never the situation, but your thoughts about it. Which leads me to the next thing that we do. It's we choose between resisting what is or accepting what is. And we always have to do one of those. There's not a third option for us. And when we resist what is, we are feeding the wolf of fear, because resistance looks like that was a bad thing, it shouldn't have happened, it was terrible, I want things to go back to how they were before. Okay, we struggle against what is. Okay, war, inflation, sickness, these terrible events that happen, people do things to harm other people. We focus on those and we say they should never have happened. Well, and we know that. We know that. But the thing is that once they have happened, we can't press rewind. Right? But see, if we're in a state of resistance, what happens is we're judging something. We only judge when we're being triggered emotionally by something that's wounded within us. Okay? When we are triggered emotionally and we're judging the situations as being bad, what happens is that we're reacting, we become powerless because we get stuck in the heartache, right? We get stuck in the heartbreak of it all. And so we can't come up with any solution. We're feeding the wolf of fear, and we can't change anything when we're feeding the wolf of fear. So what we want to do is we want to move into the space of acceptance, right? To accept what is. We know we can't change anything that's already happened. Now, but if we accept what is right here and right now, that puts us into solution-oriented mode, right? Now, acceptance, it does not mean that we go into denial, okay? Acceptance is not about like, oh, I'll just pray on it, it'll be okay. I'll just think happy thoughts, right? That's not accepting things. And when I talk about acceptance, almost every single time I talk about it, I will have somebody say something like, well, you have to be careful about how you talk about acceptance and resistance. I'm not about to accept an abusive person in my life. And I'm like, that's acceptance, right? Resistance would look like there's an abusive person in someone's life, but they say, oh, they were just having a hard day. They said they're going to change. It was really hot out, and all these bad things, they just reacted badly. They're really trying. That's resistance. Acceptance is looking at this person and saying, they are abusive, and I can't have this in my life now. Okay, that's acceptance, right? We move forward. So when we look at something like war, inflation, sickness, people who harm other people, when we can accept what is, what we understand is that source energy is present everywhere, even in those situations. They are present in the people who were contributing to those situations. Source energy is everywhere present. Now, this means that a solution can come from an infinite channels. There are solutions everywhere present if source energy is everywhere present. So when we accept what is right here and right now, doesn't mean we have to like it, doesn't mean we have to be okay with it, but what it means is that we can say, all right, source energy is in that person that did that terrible thing. Source energy is in the inflation. Source energy is everywhere, which means I can receive a solution. I can receive a solution to do something from where I am right here and right now. I can do something that will make a difference. And that's really what we want to do. Most of us will not be able to make a difference in the really big things that are happening out there. But if we make a difference in our life and then send that light out, and then they take the light and they send it out, and then the next group takes the light and then they send it out, well, that is how we affect big change. We just don't ever know what part of it we're playing. So as long as we are sending out as much light as we can in this very moment, we're going to receive the guidance. We're going to receive new direction. Okay, we're going to receive insight. We'll be inspired. We'll be given that next step, the next thing to do. Okay? So we feed the wolf of love by accepting what is. That way we can make changes. Or we can learn to live with things that can't be changed. Right? All of us know how to live with a Southern California summertime. We get through that. I know people who live in Phoenix and they've learned to live with that. We learn to live with things that we can't change. But it's a whole lot easier to do that if we are aware of what it is that works through us, for us, and as us, guiding us to do that. Right? All right, so the next thing I want to talk about, this is a fun one for me. It's complaining versus appreciation. All right? Every year, well, I first did this complaint-free challenge in November of 2007, and the goal is you get a purple bracelet, you put it on your wrist, and you try to go 21 days without complaining. Now, if you go 2 days without complaining, and then you complain, you have to switch the bracelet to the other wrist and start over. Okay, so it took me about 4 months to go 21 days. I had no idea how much I complained. I thought I was a pretty appreciative person. Because I'd say thank you to people for stuff, right? I had no idea. I just had no idea. Complaining is like bad breath. We don't know when we have it. We know when everybody else has it, right? Now, the other thing about complaining is that through the law of attraction, if we're complaining about things, we have to bring more things into our life to complain about, right? And we don't want more to complain about. We want more to appreciate, right? And appreciation is how we feed the wolf of love. Right, we find things to appreciate in the here and now. Appreciation is the antidote for when things are hard. Okay, appreciation is the antidote. When I first hurt my back, I was sitting in bed one day, and I was like, oh my gosh, my back hurts so bad. I hate my life. The universe hates me. I was like, okay, I can't stop doing that. Or I can't keep doing that. I'm like, well, I am healing. I felt a little better today. I'm making slow and steady progress. I really am. I'm thankful for that. But you know what else is slow and steady? An oak tree. I'm grateful for oak trees. You know what? Because oak tree's slow and steady, and I'm slow and steady in my healing, that means I'm like an oak tree, and I'm so thankful for that. Right? Sometimes we have to find silly things to be thankful for. Okay, like it's not raining rocks on our house. Okay, indoor plumbing. Right? Have an indoor toilet to use. Okay? But appreciation is the gateway to that feel-good energy. And through the law of attraction, anything we appreciate, well, then we have to draw more to appreciate. Okay, now I want to go back to imagination real quick. We talk about imagining our happy outcome. Now, we amp up the energy of that happy outcome by giving appreciation for it as if it has already happened. Really getting into that appreciation energy. Because remember, your brain has no idea if something's true or not. It just believes everything is true. When you're appreciating something, even if it hasn't happened yet, your brain assumes it's a done deal. The ego assumes it's a done deal. Right? So we receive even more direction and instruction to bring that happy outcome into our life. Right? So future appreciation, man, it's powerful. It's powerful. So this is all about like feeding the wolf of love, feeding the wolf of fear. This is about our thinking and our feeling, right? The sign on the other side of that door when you walk in, change your thinking, change your life. That can sound really simple and it can sound kind of trite. And sometimes when I have been really in a state, somebody says that to me and I'm just like, right, whatever. Change your thinking, change your life, right? But it's really a powerful thing because we are always creating all the time using our imagination. We're just not always consciously focused on something, right? I know what my different happy outcomes are. I'm not always consciously focused on those things. I'm imagining other things too, right? So we are always creating through our imagination, but sometimes our thinking honors our divine nature. Sometimes our thinking does not honor our divine nature, right? So it's, our thinking is feeding the wolf of love or feeding the wolf of fear. Now, we don't always realize how much we're feeding the wolf of fear, right? We think, well, you know, I said my affirmations this morning. I did some affirmative prayer. I did some positive reading. And yet, these really hard things keep happening in my life. Okay, so I'm going to give you a little demonstration of what that can look like in our normal day, all right? So, two hands here, right? This is going to be the hand of the outcomes I don't want. This is going to be the hand that represents what I do want. Every time I have a thought that supports one of these, one of my fingers will pop up. When I get to five, it's made manifest in my life. Okay? So here we go. I'm going to talk about my back, because that was quite an experience, right? So it starts off with, God, my back really hurts. Why did this have to happen to me? Man, the universe hates me. Okay, Deanna, it's all right. You're going to go see your chiropractor. Chiropractors make you feel better. I can't even sleep, right? And why can't I have more pillows? Nobody wants me to have pillows in this house. Why do I have to do everything? Okay, you can lay on your heating pad. Laying on the heating pad feels good. You can do some stretching. Okay, but I miss so many fun things. Okay, ding, 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 okay? Something just made manifest in alignment with that energy. I've only got two things here, so we're starting again. Man, this really hurts. I've never hurt myself so badly. It's worse than childbirth. Okay, you're gonna get a massage. Got a massage. Remember how good that felt? Remember when Jeanette got on that table? It's like leaning on you? How good that felt. That was good. I know, but I miss getting to play guitar at the open mic. I hate my life. The universe hates me. I can't even walk fast. I can't chase anybody. And if somebody came out, if there's a zombie apocalypse, I'd die. All right, Deanna. You had some wonderful prayer treatments from your friends. Uh-huh. Marks, you could read it over and over again, remember? Yeah, but life is really hard. Ding, 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 ding. Okay, it manifested. This is what happens to us. We think we're doing an affirmation for one thing that we really want, but on the other hand, we've just done three or four for what we don't want. So my thinking is we need to develop I have my Fitbit. Tells me the steps I've walked. We need something like this that will flash a green light when we're thinking the right things, to feed our wolf of love, red light when we're feeding the wolf of fear, and it dings to let us know when we just put enough energy into something to make it manifest, right? Okay, so it can be really hard to pay attention to every single thought we have through the day. I mean, we've got like so many thoughts in our head, but we can pay attention to how we're feeling. We can do that. We can ask ourselves right now, how do I feel? Happy, excited, okay, I'm good, right? But if it's like, oh, bitter, disgusted, resentful, oh, right. So right then and there, we have to decide to take responsibility. We have to take that right now. Now I'm going to read something, it's very abbreviated, but Ernest Holmes writes about grace. And I highly recommend that you read this out of the Science of Mind text. He says, the fall of man was brought about through his own act, so the rise of man will be accomplished through his own act. Grace is givingness of spirit to its creation, but we need to recognize it. It's the logical result of the correct acceptance of life and of a correct relationship to spirit. We are saved by grace to the extent that we believe in, accept, and seek to embody the law of good. Man damned himself and must save himself if ever he is saved. And he will save himself to the exact degree that he stops damning himself. It's our responsibility. Okay, when we recognize how we're feeling, okay, that we're bitter, we're disgruntled, we're upset, frustrated, recognize that we're feeling that and ask the universe a question. Ask the universe, well, what can I do right now? Because if we ask a question, it has to answer us. Ask for help. Right, this center has some amazing practitioners, right? And there are we have prayer request sheets. That's my first week and a half of when I hurt my back. I couldn't do anything for myself along the lines of positive thinking. I just binge watched Netflix and kept my mind off my back, right? But my friends prayed for me. My friends did treatments for me, right? Sometimes we're not yet ready to do it ourselves. But we take responsibility by asking someone to help us. That's still taking responsibility, right? See, our mind is a tool, and it just needs direction. That's all. I just think of a herd of sheep running all wild, and that sheepdog goes after it and knows how to control them, right? That's what we have to do with our mind. So we're always feeding one of these wolves all the time. Right now, you're feeding a wolf.
Yeah.
Right? So we just have to ask ourselves each moment, which wolf do I want to be feeding right now?